So there's these questions we all ask. Big questions that have a huge effect on our lives. But there's all this information out there that makes finding a solution difficult. So we came up with a better way to give you the answers that you need. We did a survey at Easter and compiled a list of your top 6 most asked questions. That list then became a roadmap for this message series. Each week, we'll examine a single question and discover God's answers based on His Word. It's a series we like to call, You Asked For It.
All right, we're continuing with our series called You Asked For It. And during the Easter season, we had a special service called Easter Sunday. And we had a lot of folks show up, and we gave a survey asking folks, what are some topics they'd like to hear about? And so what we did is we compiled them in the order in which you wanted to hear. And so today we're coming to week number 5, which is called What About Heaven? So by the time we leave here today, you guys are going to be experts on heaven. So I don't know about you, but I enjoy these type of this series. I encourage you as you leave here today, take a card and invite someone to come. Next week, we have a special woman coming. Her name is Patty Height. She lived an LGBTQ lifestyle for over 20 years. And the Lord God has set her free. And she's going to share with us. She's a national speaker. She's going to share next week about how are we to deal with the LGBTQ community. And that was one of the questions you also asked. And so in this day and age, we need to know how to handle those types of things. Encourage and invite folks to come. I guarantee you it's going to be loving, it's going to be affirming, but we're going to talk about what God says and what God has for those that are struggling in that lifestyle. Okay, everybody? So now we're talking today about heaven. And when I say heaven, what do you think? What comes to your mind when I say heaven? Often we think of a white cloud and we think something boring. I don't know about you, but I kind of used to think that. When I was a kid, they used to talk about these angels with all these eyeballs and these wings, and they say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty who was and is to come, the Lamb that was slain. And my children even have a Lego Bible. And this Lego Bible, they take all the scenes of the Bible and they make Legos out of them. And perhaps the most bizarre part of that book is when they do heaven. Looks really strange. But you know what? It isn't that way at all. In fact, it's amazing what God has in store for those that love Him. And so today we're going to look at what heaven is. What does God say about heaven? And how important is heaven in our life? And so that's what we're going to do, okay? And the first thing I want to mention to you is this, that you don't realize that God has planted heaven in your heart. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes, yet God has made everything beautiful for its own time. He has planted eternity into the human heart. No matter where you go in culture, over thousands of years, 4,000 years ago, there was a group of people called the Egyptians under the pharaohs, and they spent a lot of time thinking about the next world. In fact, they had hundreds of thousands of slaves working for 40 years to build one pyramid. And inside that pyramid, they had armies of statues. They tried to preserve the pharaoh. They went through extraordinary scientific ways of preserving the organs and the flesh that even scientists today marvel of how they built those pyramids. No, they weren't space invaders. Some people think that. But it was extraordinary, and they spent so much time preparing for the next life. Yet in America, how much time do we actually think about the next life? We just think about tomorrow, don't we? I don't want to worry about it. Some people spend more time preparing their own vacations than they do thinking about what's going to happen next. So what happens next in our lives? And so let me just move this a little bit. It's still too close. Okay. Give me a moment here. Okay, how's that? Better? It's better for me. Okay. It isn't heaven yet. If it was heaven, we would have no screen. By the way, if we were in heaven, there'd be no reason for church. I had nothing to speak about because the living word be around us all the time. So be happy when we go to heaven, there'll be no more church. You'll be the church. So planet eternity in the human heart. And so they spend all this time thinking about the next life. And yet how many times in our society today we don't think about the next life? Oh, we think, you know, heaven, everyone's going to go. It doesn't make a difference because after all, you know, my friends are there. If they're in hell, they're going to have a good time. And, you know, hell and heaven, hell is an idea. Hell is a state of mind. Heaven's a state of mind. All we have is here. One day we're going to die, and what's going to happen, we're going to meld with a big energy force in the field, and we're going to become one with the force. You know, people believe that. People believe that all you have is here, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. But what is heaven? And why is it that mankind desires to talk about heaven? Why is it world religions all around the world, they talk about heaven? Why is there so much emphasis on heaven? Because God has planted eternity in your heart. You were made to live forever. Now, if you weren't made to live forever, why would you even think about it? The fact that you long for something tells you that there probably is something, even if you're an atheist. That there's got to be more to life than just, there's got to be something perfect, and it's called heaven. He's planted eternity in the human heart. But even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work. And that's what happens. You and I, we can't understand everything about God does. And as human beings, if we can't understand it, it must not exist. Reminds me of a little 4-year-old boy that ran outside naked after a shower, ran into the neighbor's yard, and his mother comes, "Come here, little Johnny," and he closes his eyes. "I can't see you, so you can't see me." So he's convinced if he shuts his eyes, no one's going to see his nakedness. And so many times, you and I are like that 4-year-old boy. If we can't understand it or perceive it, it must not exist. But the truth is, you look in the sky at night, without the city lights and a clear sun, a clear sky, there are billions of galaxies out there. We can't even comprehend how incredible God is. And so the Bible says, but even so, people cannot see the whole scope of God's work from beginning to end. But he's planted eternity in our hearts. What does the Bible have to say about heaven? We're going to look at it today. But often there are common questions that people ask about heaven. We're going to go through a few of them, then we'll get into our topic today in more detail. The first thing is this: will my pets be in heaven? I think the dogs would be there, but I'm not quite sure about the cats. You know, cats don't have owners, they have staff. You realize that, right? There's a reason why dog is God spelled backwards, because they're godly, all right? Will my pets be in heaven? Well, we do know the lion will lay down with the lamb, so there's not going to be no more cats and mice fighting each other. There's not going to be that kind of problem. There's going to be animals in heaven. The Bible's actually quite clear about that, and there were animals, incidentally, on the earth prior to the fall of mankind. So yes, there will be animals in heaven. Will little Fido be there? I'm not quite sure if Fido will be there or not. I can't tell you for sure. But I think God is pretty creative. I wonder if that little hamster, Lily, that died, I used to call it the rat, that my daughter had, I wonder if that will be in heaven. I hope not. Okay, we'll move forward. But by the way, do you know I cry when the hamster died? Yeah, I did. You know why? Because it was important to my wife. It was important to my wife. It was important to my daughter. My daughter cared about that. And so I couldn't believe it. I was embarrassed. I made fun of this thing, called it a rat. And then when it died and she started crying, I got teary-eyed. So, you know, in many ways, that's how God is with us. He's the perfect father. I'm not. He cares what you're going through. And maybe some people today, you're going through a hard time. And you're wondering, what's the deal about heaven? Is it a real place? And is there a better way for me? And I would also say that today in our society, generally speaking, we have it pretty good here in America. People around the world in Haiti right now, they're waiting for God to come. The African-American spirituals were amazing how they talk about heaven, right? They were in slavery, and they looked to the next place. And when you have a lot and you get what you want, you don't think about heaven. We have it pretty good here, don't we? So it's easy for us to forget about it. But some common questions is, will my pets be in heaven? How about this? Why does heaven have gates? Is that because there's thieves? What's going on? I always wanted to live in a gated community, so now I can. But why does heaven have gates? Will we be married in heaven? For some of you, I have news for you. No, you will not be married. You go, whew, thank God. Some of you are saying that. Those that are laughing, they don't want to be married. If you were like me when I was 18 or 19 hearing this about there's no marriage in heaven, I was not very happy about that because I wanted to be able to fulfill my marriage responsibilities, if you know what I'm talking about. But I got news for you. There's no marriage in heaven. But whatever God has created down here, it's so much better in heaven. So there'll be no marriage in heaven. Will we have wings in heaven? You can fly around. Well, not Tinkerbells, but no, I don't think necessarily there'll be wings, but we do know we'll be able to travel quickly. I hope there's automobiles in heaven, but I'm not quite sure there will be or not, but I think we'll be able to travel around quickly. How do you know that? Because Jesus is the prototype of what you and I are going to be. He became flesh, became one of us. And what happened was he died on the cross, he sent it into hell, and he rose again, and he came back with a glorified body. And so basically, if you want to know what your body's going to be like, look at Jesus in the New Testament. He could eat broiled fish. He could pass through walls. And he could talk to people. He could be touched. But he could travel from here and there. So I have a pretty, it's pretty cool. I think we're going to be able to travel here and there based upon the Bible, based on what we see. And we even see a Moses and Elijah showing up at Mount Carmel with Jesus, showing up and disappearing. So we do have this ability to change, transform, and we do have glorified bodies, which we'll get to in a few moments. Some people are saying, how much better can your body get? I know it's hard to believe, but we will have glorified bodies. Come on. Come on. Okay. Will there be any music beside harp music? If all there is harp music, that's not heaven, that's hell. So, no, there's more than harp music in heaven. In fact, a little side note, story, I had a friend of mine, David Alash in California by Yosemite, he had a summer camp he went to, and he was playing the guitar around a campfire area. It was like dusk, and they were singing unto the Lord, they were worshiping God, and all of a sudden they heard this beautiful chorus of angelic voices. They're in the middle of the woods. There's like 10 people there, and they hear behind them, and everyone began to weep. And they wrote it in the journal. He said it was the most impactful thing that ever happened in my life. It was, I heard the angels. And I've heard stories such as that, that there is such beauty. There will be incredible music in heaven. Will there be meat in heaven? This is one area I'm a little struggling with right now, because I want to kill something and eat it. But apparently, I don't think there's going to be meat in heaven. But I think God's going to make something better than meat. It will not be tofu. Okay? Somehow or another, we're going to have barbecue something. There better be barbecue in heaven. I hope there is. So I'm not quite sure there'll be meat in heaven. We'll be meeting, but I'm not quite sure there'll be meat in heaven. And how about this? Will heaven be boring? Now, I don't think it is an accident that if I were to literally, if you're going to be honest with me this morning and say, how many of you think heaven's going to be boring? Come on, we think that, don't we? I know I had thought that. When you picture heaven, it's in white, sterile room. They have fog machines going on, and you can't see anyone's feet. And you walk around with these long white robes saying, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. You walk around, and you walk around, you're sourpuss, and you have a little harp, and these naked little babies are flying around shooting arrows. I mean, that's not what heaven's like. If that's heaven, that's not heaven. In fact, I like what it says right here. I like what Stephen King has to say. You know who Stephen King is? He read all those horror films that I used to watch. I don't watch anymore. Okay. This is what he thinks of heaven. And I think this really sums up what many people think of heaven. I don't want to go to heaven that I learned about when I was a kid. And I would agree with him. To me, it seems boring. The idea that you're going to lounge around in a cloud all day and listen to guys play harps. I don't want to listen to the harps. I want to listen to Jerry Lee Lewis. So many people think it's going to be boring and things like that. But, you know, I like what the Far Side, one of my favorite, I love Far Sides. They're hilarious. They are so funny. But, you know, he says here, sitting on the white cloud, I wish I brought a magazine. I think it's funny. It's hysterical. Thank you. But, you know, all people think that, well, what is heaven really about? Well, first of all, heaven is a real place. It's a real place. How do you know that? Because the Bible says, behold, I've gone to prepare a place. And the Greek word for place means place. And Jesus talks to his disciples, and by the way, he talks to us today. He says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Come on, is it not easy to let our hearts get troubled? Why? Because when you stop looking at God and you start looking on the celestial plane, you stop looking where God is from, you start looking below and not looking above, you can get discouraged. Is this all there is? I've worked my entire life for this? There's got to be more. Why is there got to be more? Because there is more. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house, there are many rooms. The King James says mansions, but actually a better translation is rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to what? To prepare a place. Heaven is a place. It's not an energy field. It's not a state of mind. It literally is a place. So we know that. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that also you may be with me. Let me read that again. Take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. So heaven really is about his presence. Your presence is heaven to me. Well, that's really true. What's heaven without God? My wife and I and family, we had an opportunity to, my parents went away to say, hey, listen, you just have our house, save some money, you know, go do day trips. They live in New Jersey, 25 minutes from the beach, and it's quite nice, actually. We love it. And little eateries and little fun things for the kids to do. And so we took the week, we tried to take the week there. After the third day, we're like, we want to leave. It doesn't feel like, I don't want to be here. My parents aren't here. Without my parents, mom and dad, if you're watching, my parents aren't here. It's not home without them. It's their presence that makes it special. And what heaven is not about a place, more about it's a person called Jesus Christ, that we are in communion with God. Finally, all the things that you were hoping and dreaming for come true. The completeness that you're longing for. And the reason why your husband or your wife or your boss or your friends, no one can seem to satisfy the longing you have, because no one can except for God. But finally, you come to a place where you're completely satisfied. Imagine that. That's heaven. That where I am, you would be also. And the Apostle Paul talks to the church, and they were struggling, and they were grieving, and going through a hard time. He said, listen, I want to explain something to you about heaven. And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died. People, you know, you ever think that? What happened to Aunt Martha? What happened to my parents that died? What happened to my grandparents? And I believe, according to Hebrews, there's a great cloud of witnesses. I believe. I can't prove it, per se, except the fact it says in the book of Revelation that the martyrs are underneath the throne of God, looking down, saying, how much longer? But I do believe. I can't prove it, but would you let me embellish a little bit and have a little fun on the side? Don't give me your opinion. Okay, I have good opinion based upon the scriptures. I do believe they look down upon us. You shouldn't be praying for them, however. The Bible never tells us to pray to our saints and things like that. We're supposed to pray to Jesus, the only mediator. But I believe he's looking down on us. I think our family looks down on us sometimes. I think God allows us times. And now, dear brothers and sisters, we want you to know what will happen to the believers who have died so you will not grieve. It doesn't say you're not supposed to grieve. You will not grieve like people who have no hope. It's hard. When you know somebody, you love somebody. My grandfather died. The first death in my family was my grandmother. It was very, very difficult. You know, I love my grandmother very much. When she died, but we had a happiness that we were crying. There's joy and sadness because we knew we'd see her again. There was a hope. Right? So better for them, bad for us. But there was a hope. We knew we were going to see her again. And so that is a beautiful thing we have. And the Bible is telling us, the Apostle Paul is telling us, listen, we grieve like people who have no hope. We have hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised for life again, remember, Jesus is the prototype. He was fully God, fully man. He came and did the right thing that we couldn't do. And he paved a path for us and made a way for us to God through Jesus Christ, who is God. He was raised to life again. We also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who have died. Now, this is a little confusing. And so we're going to explain it a little bit. He's like, well, I'm confused. You die, you come back. What's the story? Well, let me explain to you as we look at the scriptures. For since we believe that Jesus died and was raised to life again, we also believe that when Jesus returns, God will bring back with him the believers who died. We tell you this directly from the Lord. We who are still living, when the Lord returns, will not meet him ahead of those who have died. Now, what on earth is he talking about? Well, let me explain. When someone dies that's in God, the Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so we're going to talk about this place called paradise versus a new heaven and a new earth. There's a difference. Is it purgatory? No, it's not purgatory. Purgatory is a great ski resort in Colorado, by the way. No, but purgatory, there's nowhere in Scripture talks about purgatory. It does talk about Abraham's bosom and Jesus' parable about the rich man and Lazarus. But the Bible does talk about paradise. It is a place where there's no suffering. It is, you're on God's presence. You are with them, but you are kind of waiting. It's almost like you're going on vacation, and you come to a great place where you have a park you go to, and you have a picnic lunch. You can go swimming. It's perfect. There's ice cream trucks for the kids. and you don't have to pay for it. And it's just amazing. It's a beautiful place where God's presence is there. God is there. And we know that that place, by the way, is Moses, Elijah, all these great people are there right now. But God is going to create a new heaven and a new earth. But until that happens, there's a place called paradise. Can you wait there to? No. You either, listen, you're right with God that gets you to heaven. Okay? Paradise is another word for heaven. Are you fairly confused yet? Okay, hang on. We're going to clear it up. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a commandment, commanding shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. First, the believers who have died will rise from their graves. So what happens is, let me explain, that those that have died, their bodies are died and decomposed. But what's going to happen is God's going to reconstitute the bodies. And like a metamorphosis that takes to a, like a caterpillar that goes into a chrysalis, into a butterfly, that's probably the best example I can give you because we can't conceive it in our minds. What's going to happen is the dead bones are going to reconstitute and be transformed into a heavenly body like that of Jesus. And then they're going to come down. And then we who are in heaven, those that are here will get our new bodies as well. So what happens now? They're floating around, and no, the Bible says they're wearing robes. The Bible says that that you can tell who they are. The Bible talks about Elijah and Moses showing up, and Peter understood who they were. Even Samuel was seen by Saul when he called upon him. The Lord let him see him. So we can be able to discern who these people are, but apparently there is a body, but we're going to have a new created body. That's what the scriptures say. Obviously, I cannot go through all this would literally be an 8-week course if we went through all the nuances. I'm just going to give you the general broad strokes to help us understand. First, then, the believers who have died will rise from their graves, be reconstituted like a caterpillar to a chrysalis to a butterfly. A metamorphosis will take place. God will reconstitute, and what happened to Jesus. And by the way, just track with me here, okay? Jesus died on the cross. He went into the grave. The Bible says he rose again from the dead. He ascended into hell, and then he rose back up, and Mary Magdalene saw him in the garden. He says, "Do not touch me. I have not ascended to the Father yet." So his body was not yet transformed. But then he went to heaven, then he came back down. Then he could have broiled fish. I guess we can have fish in heaven. And he came back down, and he had a body. Okay? So that we do know, if that makes sense. That's what the Bible tells us. And so we look at what the Bible does say. We continue to look at the Bible, and it says here, as the Apostle Paul is talking to the church and us today, then together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds, there's those clouds again, to meet the Lord in the air, then we'll be with the Lord forever. So we're going to be reconstituted when we meet him in the air. All right? So that's going to happen. He's going to come down. The body's going to reconstitute from those, kind of like this, and those that are here are going to reconstitute, and we'll have heavenly bodies. Where we can travel. Wow, it sounds like Star Trek. No, it's better than Star Trek. All right? It's amazing what God can do and what he's going to do in us. Listen, even science is now beginning to figure out. They have this great collider in Europe, and they're colliding these particles at astronomical speeds, and they're finding those different realms out there. Just because you can't see it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. There are satellite beams right now. There are radio waves. There's all kinds of things you cannot see, but it's there. Just because you can't see it, it's not like a 4-year-old boy that closes his eyes. I can't see you. You can't see me. If it doesn't exist up here, it cannot be. Our mind is so puny. If you think of the universe, right? So obviously, we're not going to understand it all, but God tells us what we need to know. That's important, all right? There's nothing wrong with discussing these things over a cup of coffee or tea and talking about it. That's great. But what we need to focus on are the absolutes that the Bible talks about, and the Bible is very clear about these things. Then we will be with the Lord forever, forever. And it will be absolutely amazing. So encourage yourself with these words. Is that what it says? Okay, what does it say, guys? Can I hear you say, what does it say? One more time, what does it say? How do you encourage, how to get encouraged? Each other. Encourage each other as you'd see the day approaching. Listen, you and I need to encourage each other with this. Why? Because everything in the world says it's the here and now only. We need to encourage each other as we see the day approaching. It says in Hebrews, encourage each other. Do not give up the gathering together as some of you have made the habit of. But encourage each other as you see the day approaching. Listen, it's coming. I'm excited that everything's screwed up. I mean, I'm excited that the political system's going to fall apart. I'm excited that terrible things are happening in the world because we get to make a difference. That's a right way of looking at it, right? We get to make a difference in the world. The darker it gets, the brighter we can become. We can be the heroes of faith. For the rest of eternity, we can talk about how we were a part of it. To me, that's a great responsibility and a great blessing. So encourage each other with these words that this is not all there is. This is not all there is. You know, and in our culture, we're so blessed. Right now, we have air conditioning and heating. We have cars. We have food. You go to other places like Haiti, for example, when right now they're struggling to get something to eat. You go to other countries, they don't have any shelter, and they long for heaven. And so easy for us to get distracted by these wonderful things that God has given us. But it's only a foretaste of what's going to happen for us, really. Jesus said this. Then he said to Jesus, Jesus on the cross, there are two thieves. One was mocking him. The other guy said, hey, he did nothing wrong. What are you doing this for? And the gentleman that said that, the thief, said this to Jesus. Then he said to Jesus, the other thief on the cross, okay, was a thief, was dying, apparently didn't live a very good life. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He had faith. He believed. He believed that Jesus was it. It was the Son of God. And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today you will go in purgatory, and your relatives will light candles and get you to come to paradise. Oh, I'm sorry. It doesn't say that. Excuse me. I kind of added it in there. Assuredly, and by the way, I'm not trying to disdain the Catholics and those that do that, but it's extra biblical. That is not in the original Bible. It's good to pray. It's good to thank God for our ancestors, but it doesn't tell all that. It says this, assuredly, I say to you, today. Today means today, and I looked it up, it means today, you will be with me in paradise. There's that word paradise again, which is like a heaven. It's not the final heaven. It is a, if you will, a heaven right now. It's like moving into a house while your house is being built. You enjoy the house, it's fantastic, right? But your house is being built, and that's what's going to happen eventually. Okay, and so you'll be able to enjoy God right now. Right now, there's people you can be able to enjoy the presence of God. You can experience his presence. You can see those that have gone before us and all that. It's going to be absolutely amazing. But he's going to make a new heaven and a new earth eventually after all the earth is finally judged at the end. We are confident, yes, well pleased rather to be absent from the body and to be present from the Lord. So Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. The Apostle Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. The Bible is explicitly clear on this. Okay, there's no nuances with this. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord if you're with God. And Hebrews says, just as each person is destined to die once, and after that comes the judgment. Okay, there comes the judgment. God is going to judge us based on what we've done. For believers, there'll be the white throne of judgment where we will be rewarded on how we live our lives, what we'll get to in a few moments. So also Christ was offered once and for all time as a sacrifice to take away the sins of many people. He will come again, not to deal with our sins, but to bring salvation to all who are eagerly waiting for him. So now is the time to get right with God. There's going to come a time where the door will be shut. The ship will leave the harbor. It's going to be too late. Now is the time to get right with God. Now is the time to get the message out. All right? It also says, however is written, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. In other words, we can't even begin. I appreciate the sound effect. It will help me with my next illustration. A baby inside its mother's womb. Okay? According to what I've read recently, Dr. Kathleen Wormack, director of the Center of Pre-Speech Development and Development Disorders in the University of Wolfsburg in Germany, did a study, a scientific study, which she compared French babies to German babies. And surprisingly enough, the German babies came out, and that's how they cried. I'm German. It sounds like Klingon. I'm German. I can do that. And the French one goes, you know. But seriously, she did the research, a scientific research, and they found that babies can hear their mother's voice, and that the baby cries differently in different cultures based upon the experience they have in the womb. So when I see this, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has in store for those who love him. I want you to think for a moment. Imagine if you was able to talk to a baby in its mother's womb. Imagine a baby had a phone. It's better not that kids get the phones too early as it is, okay? But imagine a baby in the mother's womb. I'm sure if Apple, Android could do it, they'd make sure that would happen. But imagine a baby's in the womb and they're talking to us. And you're trying to explain, okay, just for the sake of this illustration, the baby is smart and intelligent and can converse, all right? Well, that's not the way it really is. Well, please, would you please humor me? Thank you. So the baby is now talking to you on the phone. You're trying to explain. Can you explain to me, what is the Grand Canyon like? Can you explain to me, what does the fall foliage look like? Can you tell me what the trees, what does it mean to go to the ocean? What is the Grand Canyon? What is Disney World like? Oh, what, you know, what is going on? Can you explain to me the Grand Canyon? Well, how about the Caribbean? Okay, let me try, okay. All right, okay, imagine this. Imagine that you're in a bunch of fluid. Okay. And you're breathing air. What's air? A baby doesn't even breathe air. A baby's bringing fluid. It has the umbilical cord. It has no idea where the air is. But you know how you feel better when you gulp in? Okay. Well, that's kind of what it's like. Imagine the warm fluid around you. You know how you hear, you know that sound of your mother's heart? You know, imagine being on a laying there, and you know sometimes when she goes out to the beach, oh, you don't know she's at the beach, but you see kind of a light coming through her womb. Yeah. Well, that's what's going to be like. It's going to be that warmth. It's going to hear. Okay, that's the Grand Canyon. Now, is that the Grand Canyon? No. But what's happening? You're trying to describe the unknowable with something that's known. And so the Bible, when it describes what happens, these extraordinary visions of Elijah, Ezekiel, John, the Revelator, I mean, all these things are like, what are they talking about? A chariot of fire? What are these angels with all these eyeballs and they cover their, what's the deal with all these, a wheel within a wheel and what on earth? Well, what's happening is this. The people that are writing it, they have no words to describe. So like a baby trying to understand what the Grand Canyon is like, that's what the Bible's trying to do to us, trying to explain what's known to explain the unknown. Does that make sense? Because think about it. We can't even figure out matter. We can't even figure out the universe. We don't even know where time, where does it end? We can't even begin to understand this. Our minds are so finite and so small. It's trying to describe to an ant this election process we're going through. I wish we could just go, okay, anyhow. Lord God, help our candidates. However, it is written, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. But what we do know is this. Revelation, John the Apostle said this. Now I saw a new, here we go, this happens after paradise, God is going to create, after the judgment, after he judges those that are not going to go to heaven, they're going to go to a place called hell, which, by the way, we're going to talk about, we're going to revisit hell. Maybe I shouldn't say revisit hell. But we're gonna come back to hell at a later date, okay? I just can't hit it all this morning. But hell is not a good place. Hell is void of God. Hell is void of hope, of love. It's a horrible place that God does not want anyone to go to. However, humanity is on a collision course with hell. A number of years ago, there was an upstate New York, there was a bridge that went out on the highway, on the interstate. And someone put their brakes on and tried to stop you in the car. Stop, bridge is ass, shut up. And the person drove off to their death. You see, we are on a collision course, and God so loved that he wants to save us from a place called hell. And he's providing us an opportunity. So, here's John talking about the new heaven and a new earth. Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. You see that? And also there was no more sea. So, get rid of your boat. Then John saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So apparently, remember, these are descriptions written to us, a finite being, to try to explain the unexplainable. And they're using terminologies that we're trying to understand. That's what's so confusing sometimes about the book of Revelation. So then later on talks about that. The New Jerusalem comes down, which will be the capital, if you will, of what God is going to do. You have the whole world, new earth, and you'll have a new heavens. And it seems like they're going to be like it was in the book of Genesis. Mankind, men and women had jobs. They did stuff. They enjoyed stuff. They created stuff. They were creative. But when Adam named the animals, that was creative. He was helping God to form and to determine the creation. He was part of the process with God. Do you realize that? Because when the Hebrew word is he named the animals, that has the same connotation as he participated in making them be what they are. It's pretty amazing. And so we're not going to be sitting around, ring, ring, ring. Another one bites the dust, ring, ring. No, that's not going to happen. What we're going to do is going to be doing amazing stuff. And so when I measured it, and so now the Jerusalem comes down, okay? This is a new Jerusalem comes down. There's no capital because the Lamb is there. When he measured it, he found it was a square as wide as it was long. In fact, the length and width and height were each 1,400 miles long, going from New York City all the way to a little before L.A., before the ocean. Can you imagine that? 1,400 miles up, 14 miles wide, a big cube. That would be the capital. Then you'll have the earth reconstituted. The lion will lay down with the lamb, all right? And we'll be able to go back and forth to heaven, and who knows what else we'll be able to do. Look at all those billions of stars out there, okay? God has a purpose and a plan for us. We're not going to be sitting around bored to death. Holy, 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 holy. I mean, it's not going to be that way. It's going to be worship. I mean, when you see something beautiful, when you see a sunset or like one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my life was the Grand Canyon. He mentioned it. It was incredible. Wow. I just want to worship God because it's so beautiful. Now you're going to see God, the perfect essence of everything that it is, and your whole body will cry out in worship, and it will not be boring. It'll be wonderful. It's like going to a restaurant and having a great meal. Like, oh, this is awesome. You know, look at the sunset. Remember having a great day? You just wish I could just stop this day and put it in a continuous loop. This day is like perfect. Okay? Perfect day. Imagine your perfect day, never ending. And even that is pale in comparison to what heaven's like. And so the Bible talks about a new heaven, a new earth, a new Jerusalem comes down. That's why Jerusalem's important, because God made a promise to Abraham. He used that line to save the whole earth. So heaven is a right place. Everything is perfect. Everything is perfect. He will wipe every tear from their eyes, and there'll be no more death, no more sorrow or crying or pain. All of these things are gone forever. Can I hear an amen? Wow, yes, finally, all the suffering is gone. You don't have to listen to a long sermon anymore. All suffering is gone. An amazing thing, finally. Everything, something's not right. Well, something will be right finally. Isn't that amazing, guys? That's beautiful, right? No more death, no more tears. And so this life, I wish I still had that rope. I couldn't find it, but I did a sermon illustration a couple years ago where I had this long rope. And I put a little bit of red tape in the beginning of it. And this represents your life. Here, you're born, and here you die. And then I took a rope and threw it across the stage. And it was a real long, couple hundred feet long. This is the rest of eternity. This is so small. This is a blink of an eye that any suffering is not compared to what's going to happen. The Bible talks about that. Heaven is also a relational place. It's a relational place. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them, and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. We get to spend time with Almighty God completely. Can you imagine that? With the creator of all the universe, your whole essence will be vibrating the frequencies of God. That sounds kind of cool, doesn't it? Well, that's what's going to happen. You're going to be worshiping God. You're going to be one with God. You're going to have your own individualism. But you're going to be with God, perfect in every way. Heaven is a rewarding place. You'll be getting rewards. It's better than credit card rewards. okay? What you do here matters. You can't save yourself. Jesus saved you. The Bible says, work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who's at work within you. Work out what God's worked in. And so whatever you do for God is both now and forevermore. People said, you can't take it with you. I disagree. You can take it with you. I've never seen a U-Haul at the end of a hearse at a funeral. You can't take it with you. You can't take the stuff. But whatever you do for God, whatever you do for God in love, and if you love other people, you are adding to your account in heaven. I'm working for rewards. Amen? I'm working for rewards. Sure I am. I just want a shack. I don't care. I want to get to heaven. Well, I understand that. But the Bible also talks about, in 1 Corinthians, talks about that what happens is many people will do stuff for themselves. Like, I'll pastor a church. It's all about my ego. When I go to heaven, God goes, you know what? I'm not impressed. That was all for your ego. You come into heaven. You're here. But all the stuff you did, that was for your ego. That's why I'm always asking God, God, I don't want to do it for my ego. I want to do it because these are your people who you love. And you give me the responsibility to look after them, encourage them, God. Let them know there's a better way. And I want to hear him say, well done, good and faithful servant. You love the people I gave you, helped you, because, you know, you're my under-shepherd. And I want you're helping the folks get to the right place. And I want to do it with the right motivation. I want to do it because I want to see this place filled to capacity. Why? So we can be a big church? No, because there's people going to hell. And God has given us heaven. And he wants to help. Heaven is a rewarding place. Look, I am coming soon, bringing my reward with me to repay all the people according to their deeds. You can't work for your salvation, but once you're saved, whatever you do for God in love lasts forever. So if you help somebody out, if you send a text to somebody and say, I'm thinking and praying for you, and you do it because you genuinely care about that person, that goes to your account. You help someone that's poor. You help the folks in Haiti. You help a neighbor that's struggling. You do things for God. You love your children well. You love your spouse well. You work at work. You work not to your boss, but you work to God. And you give an honest day wage in. You work hard. That is into your account. Whatever you do for God is both here and now and forevermore. So, yes, you can take it with you. So why focus on temporary when we can focus on the eternal? Why waste ourselves on things of sandcastles when we can build real castles? For the Son of Man will come with his angels in his glory to the Father and will judge all people according to their deeds. Once again, he's going to judge us, not to send us to hell, but to give us rewards for those of us that are in Christ. However, he will judge and separate the sheep from the goats. There's going to be a great separation, and there's going to be a place called hell. Imagine horrible suffering. Is it going to be fire? I think it's going to be worse than fire. Regret. No hope, no peace. Separate everything good and beautiful, not there anymore. It's a horrible place. It's a real thing. Judge all people according to their deeds. So we have to be living for eternity. Living for eternity, guys. Let's position our life for eternity, not the temporary. Jesus says so clearly here, says this. Don't store up for yourselves here on earth. Store up treasures here on earth where moths eat them and rust destroys them and where thieves break in and steal. But store your treasures in heaven where moths and rust cannot destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. Wherever your treasure is, there your desires of your heart will also be. So why not store for us treasures in heaven? By loving God and loving the people he surrounded us with and to make a difference. To be his hands, to be his feet. That's the way to live your life. To transcend your own life. You know, they've done studies about this, and this is the truth. They've done studies. They basically tell us what the Bible tells us for generations, for millennia, is this. When you work for something beyond yourself with other people and a higher cause, that brings the highest degree of satisfaction, according to psychologists and psychiatrists. Well, guess what? Following God is that. Amen? It's an amazing thing. So don't look at the troubles. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on the things that cannot be seen. How do you fix your on things that cannot be seen? You look to Jesus, the author and the completer of our faith. For the things we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. says in 2 Peter 3:13, but we are looking forward to a new heavens and a new earth he has promised, a world filled with God's righteousness. And so, dear friends, while you are waiting, while we're in the waiting room for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful lives that are pure and blameless in his sight. And so, dear friends, while you are waiting for these things to happen, make every effort to be found living peaceful lives that are pure and blameless in his sight. What speed his hands and his feet. And by the way, when you live for God and not yourself, you're the most satisfied you could ever be. Because everything else is a mirage. Everything else is temporary. Everything else is licking a lollipop that has an arsenic center. Living for yourself, you're not created to live for yourself. You're created to live for God. And when you live for God, you become the person you've been called to become. Now, I have to say this. There's no such thing as good news without bad news. There is bad news. The Bible says, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. Hell takes no effort. And there are many who go by it. We have to go against the flow, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way. Is it not difficult, folks? Yeah, it is difficult. Make no mistake. Which leads to life, and there are few who find it. What's going on with that? We're going to talk about hell. Okay, we can't do it all today. And you're going to understand a lot more about hell when we talk about it. But for now, God doesn't want any to perish. He wants none that will perish. People say, why isn't Jesus coming back? Because he wants none to perish. God is looking for a people. That's what he wants to do. Jesus says this, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. I've come to prepare a place for you. Then later on, he talks in this same chapter, which we began our time today. And Thomas, the disciple, says to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going, and how can we know the way? How do we get to heaven, Lord? How do we do it? And Jesus tells us what we need to do. He said to him, he says to us today, I am that great I am. I am the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The only way we can get to heaven is through Jesus Christ, who is our prototype, who is our deliverer, who is our bridge. The question I have for you today is, have you given your life to Jesus? Have you trusted Jesus for your salvation? Not trying to be good enough and do the right thing. You can't do it, guys. You're never good enough, but Jesus is good enough. Have you given your life to Christ? One day you're going to have to give an account. If you were to walk out here today and have a heart attack and die, oh, that's thanks a lot. I know, I'm very positive. But all of us have an appointment with death. Are you ready to die? Unless Christ comes back. Are you ready to die? I am. I know where I'm going. I absolutely am for certain know where I'm going. And you can have that certainty too. Not because of me being a great person. Because of a great Savior that we will trust in him. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to pray right now. And today can be your day. This is the most important thing you can do in your life. Is to make a decision for Christ and to remain in it. So you want to pray this prayer. It's not coming to church that makes you saved. It's giving your life to Christ. So I just want to repeat after me out loud, if you could this day, if you could do this. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. I ask you to forgive me of all of my sins, both known and unknown. And I choose this day to follow you all of my days. I declare that today, my life is no longer my own. I give it to you. Come now and fill me with your spirit and give me the ability to walk the path that you have for me. In Jesus' name. With every head bowed, just so I know how to better to help you this morning, say, Pastor, I prayed that prayer today for the first time or make a new commitment. Just say a quick show of hands, just real quick. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else? A couple here, a couple more. I think at least one more. I just sense. Thank you. Thank you. Come on, let's just thank God this morning. For these folks making a decision for God this morning. Amen. Listen, the journey with Christ is one step, one step, one step. We want to help you with your next steps. If you want to pull out the connection card, there's a connection card in your bulletin. We talked about it earlier. It says right here, my decision today. I'm committing my life to Christ for the first time. I'm recommitted. Could you please do me a favor and fill that out right now? We want to help you. We're going to do that, and we'll help you in the next process as we have a way to help you walk through this together. Okay, everybody? And I want to pray for the rest of us about heaven. Lord Jesus, I just thank you, Father, that you are doing good things in our hearts. I just ask in Jesus' name that we would live for eternity. Lord, that we live for you. Father, we thank you that those who are in Christ, that we both enjoy you now and forevermore. Lord, I just pray that we would remember that we would put you first, that we would put the joy of heaven before us. Father, we thank you that whatever we're going through right now is temporary, but forever and ever, we'll be able to worship you. We thank you for heaven. We thank you for the promises we have. And Father, that gives us the power and the strength to overcome the obstacles. Lord, we want to do things to get more reward. We want to bless you. We want to honor you. God, we want to hear you say in that day, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into my joy today. Lord, we want to let go of the things that distract us. We want to do what really matters in our lives. Whatever we do for you in love is both now and here and forevermore in Jesus' name. Revelation 22:17, the Spirit and the Bride say, come. Let anyone who hears this say, come. Let anyone who is thirsty, come. Let anyone who desires to drink freely from the water of life. That's what God has for us today. Amen. Let's all stand if we could. And before we stand, I know Rick got us going up and down. I'm going to do a little bit too. We have these connection cards. We want to encourage you to get ready to hand those in, okay? And right now, I want to give an opportunity to give back to the Lord. It's part of our worship. So you want to prepare yourself right now to give. That'd be great. Go ahead and do that. The ushers come forward as we do that. And I'll just say a prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray you bless these offerings today, these tithes and these offerings. We thank you, Father, as we put your kingdom first and your ways first. All these things will be added in Jesus' name. Amen. So go ahead and prepare yourself to do that as the ushers get ready. And I just want to encourage a couple things that's going to happen today. Okay, right after this opportunity here today, we're going to have something called Growth Track Connection. If you've not been through Growth Track, we have extra food and extra seats and extra baby care and child care available. It's to your right-hand side. There's a conference room there. It's called Growth Track. It's called Connection. You get to find out about Cornerstone Church, how you can become a part of Cornerstone Church. You don't have to, but you get to find out about it. That's right after this. And then we'll be having small groups throughout the week. Okay, that's what's happening today, everybody. And remember, invite folks to come next week. Patty Height's going to have an amazing time, okay? So let's go ahead and stand if we could at this time. Get hand your connection cards in as well. Thank you. Let's go ahead and have a closing song. As we're doing that, if you need prayer for anything at all, I'm going to ask our prayer team to make their way forward. Sometimes you need someone to come in agreement with you. Say, come pray with me. We're going to ask our prayer team to come forward. We're going to have a closing song. And as we do that, let's just worship God. Amen. Let's live in his presence throughout this day. Listen, we're going to leave the front open. If you need prayer, we encourage you to come forward. Otherwise, we dismiss you. God bless you. Come to Growth Track. Get involved. God bless you.